This is Memories of a Vinyl Junkie, 1967. Who would have thought what an amazing year for music 1967 would turn into? It was seriously the first year that popular albums became a thing as a full art form. Of course, there were records recorded before that in 66 with the garage band rock and the beginnings of psychedelia and albums like Revolver, of course, that had a really feel to it. Same with Rubber Soul and the 65. So artists were thinking a little differently instead of just the pop single. And for me, like many of my age, it was a time that was a time of discovery, a time of excitement in a way, and just a real time of change for a lot of reasons for me personally. 1966, I was turned 12 years old, so obviously in 60, all through the beginning of 1967, I was 12 until August of that 67 when I turned 13. When I became a man, as you'll discover in this video. Hanukkah and Christmas, either or, of 1966, I was given a sort of a clock radio. Now, we celebrated Hanukkah and Christmas. My father converted to Judaism when he married my mother. My grandparents were Russian, so there was like Russian Christmas, Hanukkah. Not that I got spoiled with all these gifts all the time, but they were like sprinkled throughout the three holidays, in fact, because of my grandmother on my father's side. So I got a clock radio, and it was an AM/FM radio. And of course, nobody I knew listened to FM radio. FM radio was sort of delegated to, you know, stations no one listened to, which was classical stations, maybe some jazz, talk, foreign language things. It was sort of the fringe of things. But in February of 19, we had a cousin. My parents had a cousin who, his name was Don, and he had a furniture store in San Francisco. A typical Jewish furniture store that had interior. And Don was someone who, we knew his family. Occasionally, all the families would get together, and of course, years later, it would turn out that Don came out of the closet and divorced his family. His wife always loved his two sons, and but he owned this furniture store, and he came over, and for some reason, in 1967, my parents decided they wanted to do a few upgrades in the house. One of which was sort of renovating my room. What that meant is getting me some new furniture or putting in furniture, because I had this ratty old bed that was my grandmother's, and it was really kind of cool. And at this point, they asked me, what color do you want to paint your room? Can you believe this? A 12-year-old kid was able to choose the color. Now, the whole summer of love hadn't happened yet, but there were tinges of psychedelia in the air and Eastern music. Because of the Beatles bringing George Harrison, introducing the sitar and Eastern, those filthy Eastern ways, as the Beatles would say. I kid, tongue in cheek. So I wanted to paint my, I remember this so vividly, getting paint swatches from my parents. My mother or father brought home these colors. And for whatever reason, I wanted an orange. I wanted to paint my room orange. Turned out I painted my, I don't know what company paint, but it was, I painted my room kumquat. I didn't paint it, but my room was painted kumquat. All four walls were painted orange. I realize this is sort of the early trappings of me getting into design and modernism and minimalism in a way. And of course, this was the time of the shag carpet. So I was able to get, when they carpeted my room with a new carpet, a short shag carpet that was a combination of orange and brown. Remember, the 60s into the 70s, orange and brown got really popular. So in a way, 1967 was a little early for this. So my room was painted orange, kumquat. My shag carpet was orange and brown. So, you know, it doesn't show the dirt that way. You could just literally throw shit on the floor and you wouldn't see it. And around two of the walls, I found, I went to the art supply store in this mall that I run my bike to, and I can't believe I thought of this shit when I was 12 years old, 12 and a half years old. I found 12 inch wide, high, brown cork board, and it was, the panels were about maybe 2 or 3 feet long. So 12 inch wide, 2 feet long. I put it in the center. I put like a strip of it on two walls. So it was this sort of strip of brown, yeah, we'll get to records, we'll get to music soon. But a brown corkboard where I could pin things up, posters, because I didn't want to put posters on the wall right away. I eventually did. But I used those for the cork. So it was orange walls with this brown cork around it, deep down chocolate brown. It was beautiful, actually. And I put things like posters. I remember I had the Who poster of Pete Townsend from Live at Leeds later on, and posters from, I was getting these Fillmore and Avalon handbills in the mail, news articles, all kinds of stuff. And they got me these two, it was two single beds. It was a time when, I don't know if you remember this, there was a corner unit that was a table, a giant table, and on one corner of the wall was the bed that you slept in all the time. On the other one was a second bed for guests, and it would tuck under that big, giant, high, square table. So where I was sleeping, right behind my head would be that table. So my clock radio was on that table. So this was a pretty cool room for a 12 and a half year old. Only child, cool. It wasn't that it was an expensive room of like high-end stuff, but it was cool for me. I'd gotten, in end of 65, a Magnavox pull-down stereo that was a stacker with the pivot speakers that you could pull apart, and that was my stereo. It was a great room. I love that room. I would play guitar in the room. If I have some pictures, I'll intersperse it here. But I remember one night, this was in February of 1966, I would listen to KYA radio. On that clock radio, I wasn't listening to FM yet. That would be later in the year, which is a big part of 1967 as well. But one night I was listening to KYA, which was one of two top 40 stations, KYA and KFRC out of San Francisco. And I heard the first Beatle song since Revolver, since August, I think, or since when Revolver came out, and was it June, July of 1966. In February, the Beatles released their first single, and it was Strawberry Fields Forever. I had never heard it. I'd never seen the Beatles until we saw this picture of them. So after being the lovable mop tops, you know, they have longer, even longer hair, mustaches, facial hair. George had the goatee at the time, Strawberry Fields and Penny Lane. But that night I was getting ready to go to sleep, and I'd always put my, the AM radio on. And of course, later at night, there are a little less commercials. There's a few specials they did, and the radio would go off by itself when I fell asleep. But I remember so vividly hearing this single, and this is the copy that I bought that week, or the week it came out. I don't remember how far in advance it was played on the radio, but Strawberry Fields affected me in a way that I would never have expected. I remember hearing the song, my eyes were closed, it was so eerie, and what was really strange, in a way creepy, it was the first time in my life, remember, 12-year-old boy, 12-and-a-half-year-old boy, I thought about dying. I thought about, not about suicide or that I wanted to die or anything, but the first time I realized that I was not going to live forever, like consciously thinking about it. And this, for some reason, this song triggered it, Strawberry Fields. I remember hearing rumors after that Strawberry Fields was a cemetery in Liverpool. Of course, it turned out to be an orphanage, not a cemetery, but that was a major, that kicked off 1967 pretty damn hard. So I'm gonna go through the records in my life in 1967. If you've seen these other videos, this has been a series. So let's have at it in a minute. Now, of course, the Summer of Love almost became this marketing, not marketing, but the media kind of created the name of that. the real summer in the Haight-Ashbury in San Francisco was really bubbling up, and it was probably, if you talked to anyone who was there, 66 would be the real deal of that area, of the counterculture, and all these young people started moving to San Francisco. Of course, with the media buildup, the music, just everything that was going on, 67 became the year that the media just, you know, plastered everywhere in magazines, newspapers, TV shows, the summer of love. There'd be tour buses going down Hay Street. I'll talk about that a little more later in this video. But it was like just a crazy friggin' scene, and I experienced it on Young Side when I was 12 and 13 years old. But there are three albums that whenever people talk about the summer of love that in a way epitomize the summer of love. They came out just as, you know, I think from late April into that whole summer. And the three albums, of course, there are other great music, but the three albums that really kind of showcase 1967, psychedelic, the change in what was going on in albums were From San Francisco, the Jefferson Airplane, Surrealistic Pillow, their second album, them being the first signed to a major label out of San Francisco, and you all know it. This is a stereo copy that I got, which I'm going to mention again later in this video. Of course, the first Doors album, Break On Through was the first single, but I didn't hear this until later in the year when Light My Fire came out, and that really, really kind of changed everything. And of course, the album in 1967, is it the best? I mean, that's for anyone to judge. Everyone has personal favorites. Of course, you know, 53 years later, it's Sgt. Pepper, Lonely Hearts Club Band. Now, this album was a game changer for a lot of reasons. I remember I'd ride my bike to this mall across San Francisco into Daly City, and there was a Westlake Music Center, and they had all these guitar amps and guitars hanging on the left wall. Down the center had the record section. In the back, they had amplifiers and drums. Little mom and pop store glass cases on the right with harmonicas and the few things. I think my first effects was something called a Boss Tone. It was a little square box you plug in, and it gave you some gain, and you had basically a fuzz. It was the fuzz guitar thing. I'd never had a foot pedal. I think the only friend of mine that had a foot pedal in 67 was a buddy who had a wah-wah pedal, but this was way before all the craziness of effects pedals and things. But that Boss Tone, which just, it wasn't a foot pedal again, on all switch and gain and volume, it was pretty fucking great. I love that thing. Remember knowing this album came out, and I can remember being at the cash register where those glass cases were, where you could look down on the case and where you could check out. And they had just gotten two boxes of this record. And for a small store to get two boxes of one record was kind of a big deal then. And there was maybe four kids standing around, and they opened up one box. It just happened to be the stereo. And as they were pulling it out, they were handing it out to us, and I grabbed a stereo copy. So that was the day I bought this exact copy of Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. Of course, again, what I remember about this band, listening to it, I played this record at least four or five times every day for a month or two. Pulling this out, obviously the insert, y'all know it. I remember that this record smelled different than any other record. Of course, looking back on it, it's the printing or something. It had this smell, which I love. It's probably ink drying or something, or stitching together. But again, you know, the original copy, a capital rainbow. So this record blew me away. And in a way, this, I mean, aside from this album being as important, and the cover, there was never a cover like this. There was never a record that came out that I knew of with lyrics like right on the back of the album by these artists. It was an amazing, amazing time, an amazing personal experience at getting this record. And of course, you could argue that this record invented rock and roll criticism. All of a sudden, writers were taking pop records, rock records, and the Beatles in particular, seriously. Ralph J. Gleason in the San Francisco Chronicle had written about jazz, and he started writing about the San Francisco bands like the Jefferson Airplane, the Grateful Dead. All these critics were taking this seriously. I think Time Magazine also had a cover story going on, but this was an amazing record, and I just remember that time again so vividly. But the San Francisco scene was getting crazy. This is a book I've shown before. Jim Marshall, photographer, great photographer, did a lot of album covers, documented the whole scene. This is about the Haight. I was born on the tip of the Haight-Ashbury in 1954, the summer, in the end of summer, August, and on the tip of the Haight. And this is a great book that really showcases pretty much what was going on from 1966, 1967. In the Haight-Ashbury, Haight Street and beyond, the Panhandle. Photographs of all the bands, the artists, an amazing, amazing book chronicling that stuff going on. So, other records, let's just go through this. The pop scene, you know, I was still a record buyer, and these are great albums that came out. This first section are albums that were, I bought because of singles, but I started buying albums rather than just singles when I could afford it. Feeling Groovy by Harper's Bazaar, LA, very poppy, almost over-the-top commercial band. They did covers of Randy Newman songs. Van Dyke Parks is all over this. Feeling Groovy, the 59th Street Bridge song, was a song written by Paul Simon. Big pop hit on the radio. Great, great, great good song. Harper's Bazaar. Another record that was all over the radio in 1967 was The Letter by the Box Tops. And the young voice who sang the lead was a very young, I think 16-year-old Alex Chilton, who you'd know later being an original member of a Big Star. But the Box Tops did The Letter. Of course, that was later covered beautifully by Joe Cocker as well. So. There's another one. Another great single, and I bought the album. To me, one of the great singles, and I never really followed him when he became a sort of a country pop star, is Kenny Rogers in the First Edition. Under the First Edition, just dropped in to see what condition my condition is. What a great psychedelic masterpiece of a pop single. You know, the whole pop, almost sunshine pop, exactly sunshine pop, like Harper's Bazaar. I'm a big fan of that, and this is a time where I started realizing, do I want to like this poppy stuff? Because everything was getting a little heavier, and songs were getting longer, but I was still hanging on. But this song, I bought this originally because of the song Windy, the association. I think their all-time great song is their first hit single, Along Comes Mary. It's got a dark, brooding, dirgy thing to it, but really catchy. Along Comes Mary, of course, everyone thought it was about marijuana. But Windy on here, and Never My Love, which is, to me, one of the such a gorgeous, sexy masterpiece of a pop ballad in a way. Beautifully recorded, beautifully harmonized. A song, the song Brown Eyed Girl was all over the radio. Of course, I'd known Gloria by them. My band was continuing into 1967. The band, if you watch 1966, you know about the Silencers, and we made that one-off record for copies for ourselves because one of the band members' father knew a recording studio owner. But as we started getting into 1967, the Silencers was sort of a poppy name, and so we ended up changing our name to the Overnight Flight. So all through 1967, we were the Overnight Flight. We continued to do songs like Gloria, but we started to do heavier songs later in the year, like Break On Through by The Doors, and a lot of the stuff from the San Francisco bands. I was getting into folk music. I had gotten in because of Bob Dylan a couple years earlier, and I got this album. This is probably one of the first folk records I remember getting. Richie Havens, A High Flying Bird, San Francisco Bay Blues, and it had a cover of Eleanor Rigby on here. Of course, a lot of people got to know him and gave him a start or a breakout when Woodstock came out, when he did that great rendition of Freedom and Woodstock. And of course, out of all the pop records, and I'll defend them to my dying day, great psychedelic pop. I think nobody made great psychedelic pop records than the producer Mickey Mose with Donovan. And if Mellow Yellow, earlier he had done Sunshine Superman. This album is wonderful, as is the first box set I ever bought, and I saved my money on. And to me, this is a masterpiece. These records were also released individually under different titles, but A Gift from a Flower to a Garden. Of course, everyone started getting involved with either transcendental meditation, or everyone was searching for something. Of course, I was 12 and a half years old, so I was just probably searching for records and, you know, barely getting in, looking at girls yet. This album comes with a booklet of all the lyrics. So a beautiful like folio of the lyrics, the original version. So if you're seeking out a copy of this, try to find it with the record. And I think Where Your Love Like Heaven is on the first one, which was a great, great song. And that's one of the songs, ironically, it was one of the first pop songs I remember ever seeing on a television commercial. I think it was for Yardley, like a women's perfume commercial. Where Your Love Like Heaven was all over it. And it wasn't really taboo yet to do commercials. That whole swing and pop Carnaby Street thing was about to explode, kind of parallel to the Summer of Love. You know, London had like a parallel experience with this whole, you know, hippie kind of thing going on. The Youngbloods' first album, of course, Get Together, an amazing anthem, Love Is But a Song We Sing, Fear the Way We Die, Come On People Now, Smile on Your Brother, Everybody Get Together, Trying to Love One Another Right Now, Mazzy Loves You. As cliche it sounds, friggin' great record, fracking great record, the definitive version, written by Dino Valenti under the name Chet Powers. Dino Valenti would was in Quicksilver, went to jail, so he wasn't on the first two Quicksilver albums. He'd come back, and my opinion, I wasn't really a fan of his return to Quicksilver. I love that band so much, but his version of Have Another Hit, A Fresh Air, was probably the biggest hit for Quicksilver, but I love this record. This, in a way, reminded me, there's sort of a folky, bluesy country, not unlike The Lovin' Spoonful, in a way, East Coast. And then they were on RCA originally, then they moved to the West Coast and lived up in Northern California. I saw them 1970, 71 several times. I'm trying to think if this is my first female vocalist that I bought an album from. This is Judy Collins' Wildflower. I had heard her music. I think I heard Both Sides Now, and I just fell in love with that song. Of course, because of that song, I'd get into Joni Mitchell. She wrote that song. And really, it was Judy Collins. Now, she became sort of this torch singer, and her records are very pop, become very pop and very produced, very orchestrated. So some folk purists didn't like that. And she had this perfect golden voice. But I tell you, she really introduced the world to some amazing songwriters, not only on this album alone, Joni Mitchell, and of course, another artist that I would fall in love into and get introduced because of Judy Collins is Leonard Cohen. On here, there's two Leonard Cohen songs. There is Hey, That's No Way to Say Goodbye, and Sisters of Mercy, and this record. Oh my God, this was so unusual when I got this. His voice, but produced by the great John Simon, who would go on to produce music from Big Pink and Cheap Thrills for Big Brother and the Holding Company. Love this record, of course, the great debut Songs of Leonard Cohen. You know, again, going back a little to the pop side of folk, as they were getting more of a commercial, probably one of their biggest sellers, I Dig Rock and Roll Music. I know the band really didn't love doing that song, but it got me to buy this record. And this is the first Peter, Paul and Mary record I got. I have a acoustic analog production version of this. It's one of the best records, best sounding records, analog-wise and audiophile-wise in my collection. It opens up with this great song, Rollin' Home. It has, of course, the cliche, beautiful John Denver song, Leaving on a Jet Plane, and the great Mandela, The Wheel of Life. But Bob Dylan, Dream, of course, they cover all these other artists as well. But this is a really great record. The little key, why is this 1700 when they're dressed in 1920s flapper and you know, mafia style outfits and vehicles, huh? It's because Warner Brothers, this was the number of catalog number. It was catalog number WS1700. So of course the name was 1700. So you think they would have dressed in revolutionary wear gear or something, but ain't gonna happen there. And of course, this is a record I did not get in 1967, but it's amongst my favorite records. This is one of the rare mono versions. So if you can find the mono version of this, check it out, Pleasures of the Hardware by the great Phil Oakes, the golden voice of folk music. This is a produced record with a great piano playing by Lincoln Majorca. It's gorgeous. It's a beautiful record. Now, I think I like the stereo better. There's a certain atmosphere of the record. But this record, amazing record. Pledge of the Harbor, Phil Oakes, who died tragically at a young age. He hung himself. A record that I bought because of the Monkees, and that is Nielsen. And a reading about, what have I read in a Pop Teen magazine or something? The Beatles really liked Harry Nielsen. And this is Pandemonium Shadows Show. They do Cuddly Toy, a song that the Monkees, Davy Jones, would cover. She's Leaving Home is on here, the Beatles song. And this is not far after Sgt. Pepper came out. River Deep Mountain High, the Ike and Tina song. Phil Spector produced the original version of it in 1941. What I remember about the spring into the summer of 1967 was my band was important to me, our band, Larry and Danny especially. The three of us were always tight. We had a few different members. We had a guy named Kirk who really didn't want to stay in. He was on the record we made. But then we kind of went in and out with a couple of different people. But we were the overnight flight. We would play at these teen club dances on Friday or Saturday nights, which is at the rec hall at some of the local schools. And we started realizing that we could play songs longer. Instead of if we played Gloria, for instance, or For What It's Worth by Buffalo Springfield, we could play it a little longer. Instead of playing like a 4 or 5 minute version like the single, we could just jam out a little bit. We could have solos and we could go on for 10 or 20 minutes when we were practicing. The band was really important to me. Records, I was a decent student. You know, I showed up for class. I didn't cut class. Of course, 12 and a half years old. I don't know, none of my friends were cutting. Must've been the Jewish thing, the family pushing. But also that spring and into the summer, I would go to Hebrew school twice a week. Tuesdays and Thursdays, Hebrew school. I fracking hated Hebrew school. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam. Of course, you would memorize the prayers over the wine, even though you're a fracking 12-year-old kid, over the bread for Hanukkah. You'd remember that one, the prayer you have to say for Hanukkah. You would memorize that. I had a Mrs. Corin was an immigrant, thick accent, almost like, you know, the Hebrew Nazi. And that's sort of a bad thing of referring it to her that way, but she wouldn't take shit from anyone. And if you didn't learn and study your stuff, she wouldn't hit you, but she would tap this thing on the desk and make a sound. We weren't getting whacked at all, but we'd have to learn this Hebrew. She also, as we got closer into knowing what our bar mitzvah portion was, would record a tape. I had a little small reel-to-reel tape recorder that my parents had gotten to me. I think maybe because of this, I wanted to do editing and make these kind of cool montage tapes and record things. But of course, we had to have one of these little tape recorders for bar mitzvah. So that was a cool thing. So Mrs. Korn, I thank you for that. And she would recite your entire Haftorah portion. The Haftorah was what you read, not just the prayers, but you read this portion from the five books of Moses. My bar mitzvah portion, since my bar mitzvah would happen on September 9th, was from the book of Deuteronomy. So I would have this tape and literally I memorize it. You'd follow along with the Hebrew, so you get an idea what it was saying, but you'd hear it. So you really, is that cheating? That's what we did. We memorized it. So to this day, 53 years later, I know like the first portion of it. Shoftim, Beshoftim, Tetenlecha, Bekol Sherecha, Asher Natalecha. See, now I don't remember it. Maybe later when I talk about my bar mitzvah, I'll remember it more. But the band was important. That shift from pop to rock. Now, a lot of these bands were putting out like two records, in some cases three records a year. Look at now, every 3, 4, 5 years a band puts out an album. The Monkees, I was still into the Monkees, who came out in 66. All three of these Monkees records were put out in 1967. And I remember our band, when this one came out, More the Monkees, we went to the mall and we asked our parents if they would buy us, go to JCPenney's. JCPenney's had these shirts. They had tags on them that were Monkee branded. This is the first kind of merchandising thing I remember as a kid of bands, because merchandising, obviously the Beatles are Beatle lunchboxes and things like that, but going into a retail store, there wasn't a lot of that then. So I had this shirt. It was a striped shirt, white collar, very mod. And I wish I had a picture of me wearing that shirt, but our band got into this. I think we played from this Mary Mary, Mary Mary, Where You Going To, which is a fracking great song. Great song, I'm a Believer, written by Neil Diamond. When Love Comes Knocking at Your Door. We also did I'm Not Your Stepping Stone on here that I believe the Porvenir Raiders also had recorded. Anyway, great Monkees records, of course. All these are great records, you know, with the Wrecking Crew backing them for the most part. I think this is actually the first one where they really were playing their old instruments. So 1967, three Monkee records in 1 year. But again, the psychedelic thing was getting even more apparent in the albums. And one of the great songs was the Electric Prunes, I Had Too Much to Dream Last Night. Of course, when you're 12 and a half years old, you think what they're really saying. You think they're saying, I had too much to drink last night, but you're a kid. But Electric Prunes, cool record. And of course, I said in one of my other videos how that in 66, I bought the first Mothers of Invention album, just sight unseen. And then I bought this in 1967. And what a record this was, absolutely free. Plastic People, The Dukes of Prunes. I thought this was hysterical. Call Any Vegetable, Call It By Name. Rutabaga, rutabaga. Brown Shoes Don't Make It. This, I actually fell in love. I thought this was an amazing record. I got into this record more than the first record of theirs, the double album. But I think this is a great record. This might be my favorite Mothers of Invention record. I mean, those of you who are younger, just watching this video, can you believe how much amazing music? Now, you might not be into all these bands and all these artists, but in 1 year, 1967, the album became so important. This, though, is a record I bought, and this is not the original copy I had, but our band tried to do this song. We were a failure because we had shitty singing, and this song is all about the harmonies. The album is good, but it's really about the single, and that's Happy Together. Happy Together by the Turtles, I'd say, is one of the great pop singles of the 60s, and one of the, maybe, you know, one of the, in the top five singles of 1967. I was in junior high school in 1967, and we had a teacher named Caroline Schwartz. And of course, this is 1967 San Francisco, so there are certain artsy teachers that really encourage, for the first time, call me by my first name, call me Carolyn. Carolyn. Carolyn Schwartz had this big nose, and she had a Barbra Streisand haircut. And you know, so basically she looked like Barbra Streisand. And we had this round music room at Benjamin Franklin Junior High School. It was a round, separate, standing room. And I was in the Glee Club, don't ask. And I started getting into stage band, playing drums, because Larry and I, who I played drums in my band, even though I switched to guitar, We both played drums. I played timpanis mostly into the stage band and the orchestra. And Larry and I would stand in the back room and kind of goof around, of course. But I took a music class with Carolyn Schwartz also in junior high school. And every Friday, this is when it started. It also happened, I think I said in another video, or a subsequent year in high school, where every Friday, this is a thing like in the 60s, 67, 68, the teacher would turn off the lights and dim the lights, maybe put a black light with a mandala poster up and play us records. Two records I have from 1967, which I'll show you, but this is one record she played. And the entire class was a whole record, so it's what, a 40-minute record or less. She played this record. And this is the 1972 or 3 copy, and I'd never, so it's a beautiful shape. But this came out in 1967, of course, Andy Warhol's great cover for the Velvet Underground and Nico. You all know the record, I don't have to talk much about it. But I remember, again, so vividly the day I heard this record. She put it on, and I remember the song Heroin. Can you imagine if in today's world, or the last 30 years, a teacher at some fracking school played a song called Heroin to their class, especially of 12, 13-year-old kids? I just thought it was this drone, this mandala. I'd never heard anything like that. It was almost no melody. I mean, you know the song Heroin, the Lou Reed song on this record. But I just love this record. This is one of the few records from this period that I think is a brilliant album. Of course, I've been a Byrds fan, and all over the radio that year also was So You Want to Be a Rock and Roll Star. This and Fifth Dimension are probably my two favorite all-time Byrds records. They can be companion pieces in a way. But this record with Have You Seen Her Face? Everybody's Been Burned. What an incredible record. Produced by Gary Usher, Mind Gardens. And the great Dylan song, My Back Pages, which is an incredible song. And this is probably definitely the definitive version, in my opinion. So the Byrds, one of my top three favorite bands. Of course, I mentioned Surrealistic Pillow before, and that's going to come up in the conversation here several times. The Jefferson Airplane put two albums out. Jefferson Airplane's Surrealistic Pillow became a huge hit with White Rabbit and Somebody to Love, the songs that Grace Slick brought from The Great Society, her other band. And but then, of course, later in the year, they put out After Bathing at Baxter's. I think people didn't get what this was about. When I got this record, I didn't get what this record was about. It didn't hit me until years later. It's a psychedelic, out there masterpiece in a weird way. Beautiful cover, weird record on the initial listening. Two songs that I think are very accessible, very commercial, Two Heads and Martha. Martha is a gorgeous, gorgeous song. So this started getting me more into this whole psychedelic thing, and Surrealistic Pillow, I started discovering San Francisco psychedelic bands. The Summer of Love was happening in San Francisco that summer, and we'll talk about more of that in a moment. I keep bringing up the term the Summer of Love because it sort of is a title, almost like a makeup title for this, a packaging term, a branding term for what happened in San Francisco and Northern California, and other parts of the world too in 1967, and that magical summer, depending on your point of view. I'm sure if you were there in the midst of it day to day, maybe it wasn't so magical. I thought it was pretty magical, but I was a 13-year-old boy. But the summer did start out with an amazing concert. And of course, I had heard about it, but I didn't really know anything about it. It was in Monterey, and that's the Monterey International Pop Festival. This took place in mid-June of 1967, the Monterey Fairgrounds. There'd never been a pop festival there. That's the location where they have the Monterey Jazz Festival every year. I attended that 4 or 5 times over the years. It's south of San Francisco, about 2 hours, give or take. This is considered the first pop festival that really kind of influenced everything after, you know, Woodstock, the good and the bad ones. However, there was a festival that same year before this on Mount Tamalpais in Mill Valley that happened. It wasn't as famous, wasn't filmed into a movie, it was more of, you know, bands like the Grateful Dead and the like. But Monterey Pop Festival was a fantastic 3-day affair. It was conceived and produced by the record producer Lou Adler, along with John Phillips of the Mamas and Papas. And actually, they even invited the Beatles. Obviously, the Beatles had just done Sgt. Pepper, and they weren't really wanting to tour and perform, and those songs weren't really performable in 1967, at least nothing like the record. So Paul McCartney actually suggested several of the artists, including The Who and Jimi Hendrix, who performed. And this is the show, the concert, and the motion picture that came out a year later, 1968, that broke Jimi Hendrix pretty much to the world on a mass scale. The Who, Ravi Shankar, Janis Joplin, who got signed because of this concert, Big Brother and Holding Company, to Columbia Records. You got to see the film. This is the Criterion version, expanded Monterey Pop, that has a lot of the extra footage that was cut out of the original. But what a performance it was. Buffalo Springfield, Butterfield Blues Band, The Grateful Dead, Simon and Garfunkel, Laura Nero, Electric Flag, Jefferson Airplane, Big Brother, The Who, Hugh Masekela, Otis Redding, Jimi Hendrix, Mamas and Papas, and other bands. There were other bands there too. That's just on this. This was a recent reissue several years ago. John Phillips of Mamas and Papas actually wrote a song that was performed at the show that became somewhat of a hit, very much a hit in the Bay Area, and that was Scott McKenzie's San Francisco. Be sure to wear some flowers in your hair. This came out in 1967 as well, and it became pretty much an anthem of the flower power generation. And again, is it marketing? Is it branding? In a way, yes, but it was a real deal. I mean, Otis Redding too really shook things up at this show. If you haven't seen the concert, the film, the expanded version, I highly suggest you watch Monterey Pop Festival. It's one of the great festival films of all time, directed by D.A. Pennebaker, who worked on the Dylan in England films, Don't Look Back, and the Maisley brothers, who worked as cameramen on it. So The Summer of Love was really starting out, and I guess this was really sort of the initial kick ass of that summer. And after this, it was just something that we all know now. We all are talking about 53 years later.
Yes.
Psychedelia. I was loving the sound of the sitar, which became sort of this part of psychedelia, merging Indian music with pop music, with folk music, with raga. I love that stuff. And it was, you know, fairly new to me. But having these teachers, even these music teachers, turn me on to things. Another record the teacher played one day with the lights out, Carolyn Schwartz, in music class, was this record. Now, a lot of people think this is a novelty record, which it is in a way. This is a record that it was sort of put together by committee in a weird way. Elektra Records, who had signed The Doors, who had recorded The Doors and Love, and had been a folk label before this, before they really got into psychedelic bands, signing The Doors in 66 and putting out their record in 67 and all these other bands subsequently, put out this record. Paul Beaver, a Beaver and Krause fame, who were early pioneers in electronic music out of San Francisco, is on here and coordinated this, as well as it was spoken by Cyrus Forian, who does a vocalize. It's called Zodiac Cosmic Sounds, Celestial Counterpoint with Words and Music. I'm a Virgo.
5 o'clock doesn't end the workday. Virgo's nimble watchmaker mind ticks on. Virgo, earthbound builder of planes, landlocked draftsman of ships.
She played this record in our classroom from start to finish, and it was just the stereo separation, the sound effects, the Moog synthesizer, the electric kind of raga aspects to it, very pop, majestic record. This is my original copy. This is when Elektra initially was putting these stereo stickers on these mono albums, because all of a sudden it was all about stereo. 67 was the year that it was all about stereo. Those of you who collect records know that in 67, 68, records were still coming out in mono, less so in 68. So that's why a lot of these, you know, 68 records especially are really rare in mono, because there weren't a lot of them, because everybody wanted stereo. I wanted stereo. You wanted stereo if you were around then. I think it's a fabulous. It is definitely a record of its time, a novelty, but, you know, you put it on the right move, you know, light one up, have a cocktail, or just do your yoga if you're clean and enjoy this record, because it's fun. It's just a fun record. This record came out, and this kind of, I bought this record and I didn't quite get it when it came out. Where everyone was doing these larger productions and psychedelic and electronic, Dylan goes back and does stripped down, bare bones, lo-fi in a way, folky, country, rootsy record. I've grown to love this record. It's now amongst my favorite Dylan records. The irony is, the song All on the Watchtower is on this record. And until the following year, when I first heard All on the Watchtower by Jimi Hendrix, I didn't know it was a Dylan song. I didn't know it was on this record. If you listen to and again, I guess I didn't know the record is that well, they're nothing alike. Hendrix obviously made his version the definitive version of this song. But even the opening song, John Wesley Harding, Dear Landlord, I Pity the Poor Immigrant, this is I'll Be Your Baby Tonight. This is such a fabulous record. And it's got the kind of the Nashville folks on here. Charlie McCoy on bass, Kenneth Buttry on drums, and Pete Drake on some of steel guitar. So this is his sort of first foray into that sort of country-ish music a little bit. Fabulous record. But as I said, the whole San Francisco scene was happening. I was homesick one day from school, and my mother was going to the mall, and I don't remember if she asked me or I asked her if she could go to the record store. And I think she felt, you know, the typical Jewish only child at home, sick. You got a Jewish mama, and she wants to do something nice for you to take care of you while you're sick. And she goes, is there a record you want? And I said, well, I do want this record by the Grateful Dead. I remember her look like the Grateful, what kind of fakakta name is the Grateful Dead? Yiddish. I'll do it. I knew some Yiddish back then. My grandmother and mother did, you know, fakakta. What kind of crazy name is that for a band? But she did buy me this record. She brought it home because I had heard Golden Road to Unlimited Devotion was played a lot on San Francisco radio. KYA would play this record a lot, and it became a staple. And I loved Cream Puff War too. Just what a great record. Very unusual for what they would do later, with their live extended song. This should have been a bigger hit all around the country because it's a fabulous record. The original Grateful Dead record, standing in front of their house at 710 Ashbury, which is just right up a few stores up from Haight Street, so right the corner of Haight and Ashbury in San Francisco. And during this whole time, I was really getting into these San Francisco bands, and I would get every album. My mother worked in a department store. I remember going in and meeting her one day, and she would get discounts at the Emporium, and they had listening booths, and I could listen to it. And I got this record because of two songs I heard. I heard Down on Me. Of course, Janis Joplin would be, you know, we all learned about Janis Joplin, of course, after Monterey that year. They got signed to Columbia because of Clive Davis. And our band did Light is Faster Than Sound and Blind Man on this, and Caterpillar. We did three songs from this album because we love this record. Not all sung by Janis Joplin. There's like two or three songs sung by Sam Andrew on here. And is it Sam Andrew or is it James Gurley? But other vocalists on here, not just Janis Joplin. But what a great record, their initial record. This is a Sunday's reissue. Another band that out of the East Bay, out of Berkeley, that I fell in love with, and they did two albums that year, Country Joe and the Fish, Electronic Music for the Mind and Body. This got local radio play. Now, this is one of the first records I remember getting turned on to because of KMPX. KMPX was FM radio. All of a sudden, Tom Donahue took over a little station. Tom Donahue was an AM DJ who had produced the first Beatles concerts, and then he also produced the first album had Autumn Records, not produced, but signed and got Bo Brummels together. It was produced by Sly Stone from Sly and the Family Stone. Their hit in 1965, Laugh, Laugh. Was it 64 or 65? They were sort of the first American answer to the Beatles, the Bo Brummels. Great fracking single, Laugh, Laugh. But they were playing Not So Sweet Martha Lorraine from this album, as well as Happiness is a Porpoise Mouth. And The Masked Marauder, I remember that. Great record. So I got this record, and of course later this with the fish game, a pull-out poster that you could cut out and have a fish game. This is, to me, a gorgeous record. Janis, the song that Joe McDonald wrote for Janis Joplin. It's got the fish cheer, which became famous during Woodstock by them. Who Am I? Magoo, Colors for Susan, Eastern Jam, again with some raga rock influence, lead guitar playing. Amazing record, amazing psychedelic folk masterpiece in my mind. Two amazing records by Country Joe and the Fish. And of course, probably one of the best debut records of any of the San Francisco bands in a way, I would say, is this Moby Grape, first Moby Grape album. They get screwed by Columbia because Columbia puts out five singles thinking it's a promo gimmick, and nobody knows that they really should be playing the song Omaha only. Famous cover by the photographer Jim Marshall, San Francisco photographer, with the flipping off the finger that was later retouched out. Came with a beautiful poster that is inside here. I'm not going to pull it out right now. An incredible record, 805, a beautiful folk ballad, country kind of ish song. Great record here, Moby Grape. And then going back to the Bo Brummels, the album from 1967 they put out. I got this record and I didn't get it when it came out. And of course it became a cult favorite years. Bo Brummels didn't sustain. They weren't really part of the Summer of Love and the whole psychedelic movement at that point. So they kind of don't get their due as far as I'm concerned. Bo Brummels, and then of course later they did Bradley Barn out the next year. So all through 1967, Larry and Danny and I, our band, were really hanging out. We were like brothers in arms. All we did was hang out together. On the weekends that summer, I remember we would go almost every weekend with Larry's parents. They'd go to a picnic in Golden Gate Park. They were more adventurous than my parents about going out to these places because I think they were about, looking back on it, they're about at least 10 to 12 years younger than my parents. I think they were very young when Larry was born. They'd drive to Golden Gate Park and we'd hang out an area that became known as Hippie Hill, right adjacent to Stanion Street, the edge of Golden Gate Park, and right where Haight Street butts into it. You know, this is the time of the hippies and drugs, and you literally could not drive down Haight Street. A couple times with my mom, we drove down during that whole summer. It was incredible. It was stop and go traffic on the weekend. You couldn't get through. There were tour buses and people were gawking and looking at the hippies. There were stores we'd go into, and being this young kid, that was the summer that was so special in San Francisco because it was one of the rare all sunny, it seemed to be at least looking back on it. It was sunny all summer. Obviously, you know the phrase about the coldest winter I ever spent was a summer in San Francisco by Mark Twain. It gets foggy a lot in San Francisco, especially right that area near Golden Gate Park and the Richmond District and the Sunset District. So it's kind of a foggy area. There's the panhandle that goes into Golden Gate Park where there was a famous show of Jimi Hendrix. There were concerts. I'd ride my bike. Larry and I would ride our bike. We would see Big Brother and Holding Company, The Grateful Dead, Jefferson Airplane, other bands play in the park, and it was amazing. So we would see these bands at an early age. The Hall of Flowers, we saw The Grateful Dead, Haight Street, all that stuff. But Haight Street had these amazing stores. The Print Mint was one of them that had posters and psychedelic day glow, black lights and lava lamps were kind of just starting out. There would be these head shops and there would be hippies selling the two major underground newspapers of the day, the Berkeley Barb and the Oracle. And they were underground newspapers. The Oracle was more of a, had some color in it. Berkeley Barb was black and white, cut and paste. I remember about the Berkeley Barb, it was not censored at all, even though the Oracle wasn't. But there was like, you know, just full nude pictures of men and women and a lot of pubic hair showing. And you know, you're a 12-year-old, 13-year-old boy, you see this stuff. And it wasn't like, you know, Playboy nudity. It was kind of, I wouldn't say it's raunchy, but looking back on it, you know, when you haven't really seen that stuff in those days in 1967, it was kind of interesting. I bought a couple issues of the Berkeley Barb, but I bought a lot of copies of the Oracle. And it was cheap. I forgot what it was. But years later, at the Folsom Street Fair, and I think it was, what year was it? Let's see. I bought this book, 1991, edited by Alan Cohen, who was the original editor of The Oracle. And this is a bound version of the all the copies of The Oracle. And I just couldn't resist. And he signed it to me. And it's just a magnificent archival representation of these memories. Let me just show you a few pages because I mean, there's things about social justice, injustice, shows like poster facsimiles, articles on music, about sex, politics. I just loved the psychedelic culture. Timothy Leary, Summer of Love, the events going on. I suggest you know, if you want to read more about this, this book I assume is long out of print and was more of a private press. It's probably pretty rare, but this was an amazing thing. I remember walking down Haight Street and people, you know, up to Larry and I trying to sell us drugs, and we were not into drugs at all, so we just would walk by and they wouldn't hassle you. It wasn't like what you see today, you know. It was wonderful. It was music. You could smell incense everywhere. You could smell patchouli oil everywhere. It was music blasting out of almost every storefront. To continue on with some records, I'm going to show this record because everyone now knows about Love Forever Changes. But I'm going to make a confession. I never heard this record until the 1990s. For some reason, even working in record stores in the 70s, even beyond that, it's become this cult classic. It didn't really sell a lot when it came out. It wasn't a hit on the radio. What I remember about Love is their single, the Baccarat Hell David single, My Little Red Book. And they had some pop singles in 66 into 67, but this masterpiece that we all know now as a masterpiece was off my radar until I finally picked it up. Of course, now I love it. So I'm showing this just because it's an important record for the year, but it's something that missed. An LA band that with Arthur Lee, John Eccles, Brian McLean, Ken Foster, and Michael Stewart. And it's an important record. And Jock Holzman was the founder of Elektra Records. And of course, co-produced by Arthur Lee with Bruce Botnick, who worked on All the Doors records. So again, an important LA band, out of my radar initially when I was 12, 13 years old. But I was getting into these weird little dirgy kind of things because of psychedelic covers, and I got this record, Pearls Before Swine, at this local store in Westlake, this music record store, because of this cover. It's almost like a Hieronymus Bosch painting, but it's not. It's, let's see, front cover, Detail of a Garden of Delights. Oh, it is Hieronymus Bosch. I know my artwork. This is their first record on ESP record. I didn't know this at the time. ESP was a New York East Coast jazz label that never hardly paid their artists. And Tom Rapp, who was the head of this group, folky, dirgy, you know, in a way, psych folk, before we call things folk psych or psych folk. We didn't know what that was. But I loved his voice. He sings with a kind of a lisp. And I bought all his records. I bought all the records when they went on to Reprise in later years. One Nation Underground, the first record of theirs. And this is a very early copy, definitely. But an amazing, amazing record. Second album, I believe, by the 13th Floor Elevator. Of course, You're Gonna Miss Me, we all knew. This is from the box set, the International Records, the label that put all this stuff out, that I got in the 80s. And I realized, and this is probably, you're going to all scream at me, I have this whole box set of their whole catalog, and I never opened any of the editions. So these are 80s additional international artists. This is Easter Everywhere by 13th Floor Elevator. So I didn't buy this record in 1967. Of course, Nico, Chelsea Girl, another record I didn't get in 67. I got this into the 80s when I was kind of going back into this whole, like, scene of this type of music, of the psychedelic and the dirge in New York and the German art scene, even though she was in New York, this record. I like this record a lot, because I heard These Days, isn't that a Jackson Browne song? These Days, very early Jackson Browne song. It's amazing how early that is, really. On Verve Records, Chelsea Girl. My teachers in high school, or in junior high school, would play this record in Live Wire Blues Power by Albert King. You all know this record. This is my introduction to electric blues. I would see Albert King's name a lot because during this whole time when I'd go to Golden Gate Park, I remember Larry and I don't know exactly how we signed up, but we signed up and started getting handbills from the Fillmore and the Avalon in the mail. We were too young really to go to these shows, but these are a selection from my collection of handbills of the Fillmore. And if you look at these groups with, like, for instance, Pink Floyd, Big Brother, The Holy Kid, Richie Havens, Winterland, Donovan, H.P. Lovecraft, Mother Earth, Chambers Brothers, Sunshine Company, Siegel Schwall, Blues Band, Nitty Gritty Dirt Band, Clearlight, Blue Cheer at the Fillmore, The Birds, The Loading Zone, Jefferson Airplane, of course, Gabor Szabo, and Jimmy Fracking Hendrix. So I would get these and just marvel at the psychedelic. Remember that room where I had that kumquat room of mine? I would have these pinned up. And so some of them have pinholes now, but I finally preserved them. So I'm studying bar mitzvah. I'm studying bar mitzvah. That's what you call it. All summer, playing guitar, playing in our band, study bar mitzvah. Some other band, just some other records. I think one of the great pop psychedelic masterpieces is the first Bee Gees album. I got this record because the radio was playing Holiday. I later got to love New York Mining Disaster, which was a single. I don't remember being a single, but this is beautiful harmony. And of course, the great song, Please Read Me, which later the great Nina Simone would cover. So I love that record. Between the Buttons, Rolling Stones Flowers, and American Comp. I stuck with the Stones on all these comps. Great records. Actually, this is a kind of, even though this is a comp that they put out, which wasn't really a full album normally, great singles on it. Ruby Tuesday to me is one of the great great singles by the Rolling Stones. As is Lady Jane, Out of Time, Let's Spend the Night Together. So some of their great songs. This is a really great record, even though it's not a record that Stones made as an album, but I love it anyway. Another one, blues, psychedelic pop, more on the blues side. They came from the Yardbirds. I remember getting into them because of Over Under, Sideways Down. But this has Little Games and Tinker, Tailor, Soldier, Sailor, Little Soldier Boy. But this is actually a cool period. This is, I believe, when Jimmy Page joined. So it, I liked it, but I didn't really love it at the time. And of course, one of the great albums I remember getting early on is this Pink Floyd record. This is where San Francisco scene and the scene and what was happening in London were parallel. With the ballrooms were happening in San Francisco, the Avalon, the Fillmore. Bill Graham was doing shows at Winterland. Chet Helms was doing shows at the Avalon. And in London, Joe Boyd, the American expatriate producer who had produced the first single by Pink Floyd, ended up producing some John Martin records, some Incredible String Band, Fairport Convention, the whole folk UK scene, co-produced shows at a club that he started with another person, the UFO Club. Pink Floyd became the house band there. So that was happening. And of course, expatriate Jimi Hendrix with this incredible album. I mean, two albums in 1 year. These two records in 1967. This record I fell in love with. I didn't get this record till probably in 68 or 69. I didn't get it right away. Larry got this. I'd listened to it at his house. But I got this one. And of course, Purple Haze, Foxy Lady. Obviously, the American and the UK configurations are different. I don't remember which is which right now. This is a reissue, a mono reissue, I believe. Yeah. That came out several years ago. But love Jimi Hendrix. And he was all over my turntable then. Of course, the first Traffic album that was called Heaven Your Mind, they changed it to Mr. Fantasy because Dear Mr. Fantasy was played all over FM radio. And what was happening is FM radio, that clock radio I had by my bed, KMPX started in, I think, April or May of 1967, and the first underground radio began because of Tom Donahue buying KMPX. And all of a sudden, we could hear in stereo, even on my clock radio, it sounded different, it sounded better. Even on that wonderful tabletop radio, it sounded better than AM radio. And from then on, I hardly went back to KYKFRC, KSAN, or KMPX, that later became there was a strike, and a lot of the DJs went over later that year into 68 and started KSAN. This was the beginning of underground radio, and I would hear songs like this by Mr. Fantasy. I would hear long versions of Grateful Dead songs and Jefferson Airplane songs. I remember a song I don't have here right now by the great folk artist Tom Paxton, Talking Vietnamese Potluck Blues. Great, great song. And of course, songs by Cream. They were playing all the songs, whatever the DJ felt like playing, whatever worked together. Very few commercials then, mostly waterbed commercials, commercials for Levi's and jeans, for record stores and ticket shows and that type of thing. This stuff changed everything. FM radio for me changed everything. There would be montages, there'd be experimental stuff. They would sometimes play jazz and classical, play a Beethoven piece or a Brahms piece at overnight at 2 a.m. Because sometimes I'd wake up and I put the radio on. I could not get away from the radio. Now, this became a hit in 68, but late 67, this was recorded, Time Has Come Today by the Chambers Brothers. What a great long soul psychedelic. As I recall, it's the first psychedelic soul song that was popular in 1967. And of course, you know, the thematic albums like Sgt. Pepper, which is not really thematic, but had a feel, a flow. There was less space between the grooves. That's what was happening in 67. You didn't have 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 of dead wax between tracks. You started merging things together like Sgt. Pepper, where the one track would literally clip right into another track. And of course, Days of Future Past by the Moody Blues, their second album after Denny Lane left the group, which is an amazing record. You would hear Tuesday Afternoon, there was a clip single of that, and Nights in White Satin all over AM radio, but they would play long, you know, sides of this record on FM radio, and it was a masterpiece. It's just this classical sound of this record when I first heard it, and I actually remember my dad coming in and asking me what that was, what was I listening to, because he heard this sort of majestic, uplifting, beautiful, not dirgy, but just very popular, like classical music, and it was really lovely. Of course, Eric Burton and the Animals became Eric Burton and the Animals after the Animals. He has a whole new band, he's doing psychedelic stuff. He later go on to do Monterey, but on this record, San Francisco Nights, of course, the AM radio played that song. And of course, A Warm San Francisco Night is something very rare. The most played song in the history in the United Kingdom in bars, jukeboxes, or radio is Wider Shade of Pale. It is not on this album. This is the Italian album. The original UK version did not have the album. But of course, in America, there's unfortunately electronically altered for stereo version that tacked on Wider Shade of Pale. Great song, the great soulful, white, blue-eyed singing of Gary Brooker, the great Hammond organ of Matthew Fisher, great lead guitar, Robin Trower, David Knights on bass guitar, and an amazing drummer in B.J. Wilson. Amongst my favorite band. I did get this single, and then I got this album when it came out. And I didn't know the difference, what electronic process for stereo meant. Nobody had issues with it in 1960s, as I recall, at least fans of music. And of course, my favorite band That would become my favorite band, maybe because of this song, even though I liked their first albums. But Waterloo Sunset, to me, again, in my top five singles of 1967, Waterloo Sunset by the Kinks would be on it. And the Kinks, Something Else, is a fantastic record. David Watts, Death of a Clown, Harry Ragg, End of the Season, incredible record. The Kinks. When I'm talking about long albums and psychedelic, and prog music wasn't a thing now, but looking back on it, I think my first exposure to something that would become prog-lite and that neoclassical thing, there's all these labels we put on bands now and subgenres, but Vanilla Fudge. I got this record, and I'm going to talk about this in a minute. This record, I bought this because of Keep Me Hanging On, the Supreme song. It was unusual version of this, of course, their version of Ticket to Ride and their version of Eleanor Rigby. So, great record and became such a classic. And of course, one more record I'll show that literally I didn't get until probably 1970, and it's a great Thanksgiving record, is Arlo Guthrie's Alice's Restaurant. The entire side one takes up the 18-minute version of Alice's Restaurant Massacre. It's one of those songs I really can't listen to a lot because it's like a comedy album, but it tells a story. It's kind of a cool story. It takes place on Thanksgiving, so a lot of people sort of dig this record out and on Thanksgiving. But of course, it's the great, he's a great son of Woody Guthrie. So that was a record that I got in 1970, but came out in 1967. So, I was bar mitzvahed finally, September 9th, 1967, Temple Judea on Brotherhood Way, a modern synagogue that was built in the mid-60s, really kind of nice purple carpets and purple light through the stained glass windows. And that's what I remember about that. Rabbi Morris, what a great, great man and a great rabbi. And I remember the morning of my bar mitzvah. I woke up, and what I remember about it, there was a cartoon that debuted that morning on Saturday morning cartoons. It was a morning version of Spider-Man, and I watched that. And that morning, I was watching Spider-Man, and I was nervous as hell. My bar mitzvah was a Saturday morning bar mitzvah, which would, I think that means it was like 10 or 11 a.m. But I got up early, watched Spider-Man, and all of a sudden, I thought I was having a heart attack. 13-year-old boy having a heart attack. I mean, obviously, I was scared shitless. I was having like nervous pains. First time in my life that ever happened to me. I got over it. I went, had my bar mitzvah at Temple of Judea. Shoftim, Veshoftim, Titen Lecha, Vekol Sherecha, Mishvateh, Veshua, On, Hanat Tzedek, Lo Tatia, Panir. See, I can't even remember now. For decades, I remembered the whole Haftorah portion in Hebrew. What I did get, my bar mitzvah present for my parents was a guitar. I had this St. George guitar, which was like a battle axe. You could hardly press the strings. Really kind of cheapo, shitty guitar. But, you know, it's what you get when you're starting out. And I was finally playing guitar for 2 years now. And my parents had a friend who owned a pawn shop. Of course, all Jewish people have friends that own pawn shops. And in those days, and even today, a lot of the Jews own pawn shops down on 3rd Street in San Francisco. And they picked out the guitar, and what a guitar it was. This was 1967, it was used, but it was a 1963 or 64, I never remembered which, blonde Fender Jazzmaster guitar. So in those days, I mean, now that thing's rare as hell. Those days it wasn't rare, but it was a beautiful guitar. Of course, I did have a little thing, you know, by this point, that was a surfer guitar. Like the Beach Boys would play those guitars, the Ventures would play those guitars. It wasn't a psychedelic guitar. You never saw any of these psychedelic bands, as I recall, play Jazzmasters or Jaguars. They're playing Strats, and not even a Telecaster. They play Strats. They play Gibsons. They were playing different guitars. They weren't really playing those guitars yet until, you know, 10 years later or so. The new wave bands and Elvis Costello would play a Jazzmaster, and Jaguars became, you know, later Sonic Youth. All those bands, now you can play any freaking guitar, but it wasn't hip. So unfortunately, I think around 1972 or 3, I sold it and got a Strat. But this was a beautiful guitar. You're going to see it, I think, in one of these pictures coming up. But that was my bar mitzvah. I got that guitar.
I am waiting. I am waiting. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I am waiting. I am waiting. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Waiting for someone to come out of somewhere. Waiting for someone to come out of somewhere. Hold out, you can't hold out. Oh yeah, oh yeah. You can't hold out, you can't hold out. Oh yeah, oh yeah. Waiting for someone to come out of somewhere. Waiting for someone to come out of somewhere.
Came to the bar mitzvah and he gave me three records, one of which I already showed. His bar, he was my non-Jewish friend who came to my bar mitzvah, one of them. And he gave me, I finally got a copy of Surrealistic Pillow. I've wanted this record, but I hadn't gotten it yet. It was out for several months, but I finally got it on my bar mitzvah. He gave me Bobby Gentry's Ode to Billy Joe, which was a top of the charts, definitely. I love this record. It was unusual for him to buy me this record. But I loved it, and I'm glad. This is a later reissue of the record. Of course, you can get these records dime a dozen, but it's what a great song. Bobby Gentry is fabulous, and I'm glad she's being rediscovered. And he gave me this record. Bill Cosby was huge in the 60s. Bill Cosby was on I Spy, the TV show with Robert Culp. His comedy records, Why Is There Air? His bit about Noah's Ark. I'd listened to those records. I loved it. This was an album that was basically him singing. Silver Throat, Bill Cosby sings. And the hit on this was Little Old Man, A Little Old Man. This is a good record. Obviously, where we are now with Bill Cosby, I probably shouldn't like this, but this is Bill Cosby sings a rocking soul record, cult record, not politically correct record, but Danny gave me these two records for my bar mitzvah. 1967 was a long friggin' year. I turned 13 years old. I'm a man. So it all started with Strawberry Fields that year in February, thinking about, I'm not gonna live forever, thinking about dying. But it was sort of a peaceful. It wasn't like I was afraid of it. It ended in September. The fall was my bar mitzvah. I was still playing with my band with Larry and Danny, who are amongst my best friends. Life was good. I was a kid. I was a 13-year-old. I was riding my bike. I had my new guitar that fall. We would play every weekend in my garage, Danny's living room, and Larry's sort of room off, he had like a rumpus room off his bedroom.
Strobe lights beam, creates dreams. Walls move, minds do too. On a warm San Franciscan night. Old child, young child, feel all right. On a warm San Franciscan night. Angels sing, leather wings. Jeans of blue, Harley Davidson's too. On a warm San Franciscan night. Old angel, young angel, feel all right. On a warm San Franciscan night.
I wasn't born there. Perhaps I'll die there. There's no place left to go. San Francisco.
What a year 1967 was. At the end of the year, the Beatles put out one more project, a film and an EP, and that was Magical Mystery Tour. Now, the EP came out in the United Kingdom, and it had the songs from the film. The film only debuted in black and white on Boxing Day in the UK, and that's the day after Christmas. And of course, it was the first time the Beatles really had bad press, big bad press, big bad press. People just hated it. They couldn't pay attention to it. It's a strange film. It's like a Fellini film. It's bizarre. And it at least it should have been shown in color, but in black and white on these little tiny television sets in the UK, it was a disaster for the most part. However, the music was fabulous. And of course, in the United States, the music came out on a full album, which has side one, all the songs from Magical Mystery Tour, and side two, all these fabulous psychedelic singles and songs that were sort of, I don't want to say leftovers, because All You Need Is Love from the Our World, the first worldwide satellite broadcast of the Beatles, represented the UK. All You Need Is Love, Strawberry Fields Forever, and Penny Lane, those great first songs that started this whole year off for me, were on this album. Baby Rich Man and Hello Goodbye. Of course, I'm the Walrus, and we know all these great songs from Magical Mystery Tour, Blue Jay Way, Your Mother Should Know. Fabulous record, not a total success cinematically. And in America, we wouldn't see this film for over a decade. Now, it did show up in San Francisco, and it showed up pretty soon afterwards in San Francisco as a benefit for the Straight Theater. The Straight Theater was right on Haight Street. It was actually an old movie house called the Haight Street Theater, the Haight Theater. And of course, during A Summer of Love and Beyond, it was changed to the Straight Theater. And the film showed as a benefit. I did not see that film. I did not see it till well into the 1970s for the first time. So, I'm ending the year 1967 with Magical Mystery Tour, the Beatles, of course. It starts with the Beatles, it ends with the Beatles, which it kind of pretty much did almost every year that mattered in 1967. Mazzy loves you. San Francisco, you're gone.